see so many of you attending. And what I would like to do is discuss a number of things that we have realized in the context of Work Package 10 and beyond. Now, we are concerned, of course, to a large extent with small trials, small studies. At the same time, some of the methodology that we have developed is also applicable to large studies. So I will basically combine the two ends of the spectrum, very large and very small. So with that in mind, I should also give proper acknowledgement to a number of people in our research team and beyond who have worked extensively on this project. There is a list of people who have contributed, but in particular, I would like to mention Wim van der Els, who is also actually on the list of participants today and who has made very important contributions to the work within this package. So I would like to start, and I'll try to be as non-technical as I can in most places, but every once in a while I'll have to make a small technical excursion, so please bear with me on that aspect. A principle that I will be using throughout in various forms is pseudo-likelihood. Now, pseudo-likelihood is actually a way of replacing a complex likelihood that we use for estimation by a simpler function. A simpler function which, and that's very important, is no longer a likelihood and therefore needs special treatment, but which makes estimation in a hostile environment. And by a hostile environment, I mean when you don't have a lot of data, but on the other hand, also when you have massive amounts of data and just manipulating a likelihood function becomes very difficult. So, for example, in a setting where you would have, let's say, three measurements, three repeated measures, and think, for example, of a study where a patient is examined at three subsequent points in time, factorization, where you take a later measurement factorize it and condition it, sorry, on earlier measurement, seems an obvious way forward. But what you can also do is, for example, and that's what's given here on page 2 in red, you replace that function by all conditionals where every outcome is conditioned on all of the others. Or what you can also do is you say 3 is too many, but here you can think of a small number of patients, but with long sequences of repeated measures. If these sequences are too long, just break them up in all possible pairs. And you see that I drew arrows between the left-hand side and the right-hand side. The reason is these are not equalities. So what's on the right-hand side is not equal to on the left-hand side. And even if the left-hand side is what you should use in classical likelihood estimation, we are going to use something like what you see on the right-hand side, simply because it's actually easier to use, but at the same time, and that's very important, also because it can lead to better conclusions. That's, of course, first and foremost. So, in other words, if you have a patient I with a number of repeated measures, and again, even though the number of patients could be small or extremely large, also the number of measurements can be reasonably large, well, then you replace a potentially complex likelihood by a number of factors that are easier to manipulate. You're using the wrong likelihood, but you get the right result. And by the right result for the more technically oriented people, I would say consistent, asymptotically normal. Now, that's nice. Mathematical statisticians like that, but in practice, there is more to it than that. Very important is we can do so frequently by incurring small, slight loss of efficiency, not much more than that, but huge gain in computational efficiency. And by computational efficiency, I mean two things. Speed, evidently, if you have to wait for hours and days or months, versus we can do it in few days, then, or in a few minutes or a few seconds, that's of course much better. But at the same time, computational efficiency can mean you get a result, whereas the full likelihood, while very principled, may not be able to provide you with a result at all, because your data set is so small that convergence of your likelihood, convergence of your procedure, doesn't seem to happen. Okay, so with that in mind, I will try to make it more concrete as we go over, actually throughout the presentation, by considering a number of uses of this particular setting, because it's actually a very rich structure. Think of the following setting, and again, the methodology provided can be used in a clinical trial setting, but also beyond. But we can fix ideas still and think of a small clinical trial with not too many patients, but on those patients we collect a large amount of data. And for that, I would like to give an example that's now already several years old that my colleagues Stefan Hughes and Geert Molenberghs developed. Suppose that on every patient you not only measure a sequence of repeated measures, you do that, for example, for a number of different indices. And in this example, we consider a hearing study. So patients with hearing problems are recorded for 22 different outcome variables on the left ear and on the right ear, making it 44 sequences altogether. And these sequences are indeed repeated measures over time. So we have multivariate longitudinal data. Okay. What you can do is say, okay, fine, nice. I will fit a nice hierarchical model to these data. And you can have 100 patients, you can have 10 patients, you can have 1 million patients. So medium size, large, small. But the fact is, we have many sequences, and these sequences can potentially be long. Likelihood is often not going to work. It's simply too complex. So pseudo-likelihood ideas can be used. Okay, so. Another thing that we can do in a context like this is so-called split sample methods. And I will expand on that as we go. Split sample methods is if your sample is too large, too big, break it up into subsamples. For example, if you have 1 million subjects, a study with an epidemiological study or whatever, of 1 million subjects, in a moment that will go small as well. You may break it up into, let's say, 100 subsamples of size 10,000 or 10 of size 100,000 or whatever. But if your sequence of repeated measures is too large, you could actually also do the reverse and break it up such that you break the sequence longitudinally, like the first 100 measurements, the following 100 measurements. So in other words, you take a sharp knife and you split your data set into sub-data sets. What then next? Well, the next thing to do is we will then analyze each of those sub-samples separately. Analyzing them separately versus analyzing them all together, that seems like, again, you're deviating from the classical way of estimating parameters, you're deviating from the likelihood. So the consequences might be that I lose information, that I lose precision, maybe that there is bias, etc. No. We can show, if we do it well in some very simple settings like a univariate normal, so think of a univariate normal where you want to estimate the mean, but you have a huge sample size, you do that for every subsample separately, and then later you average, because that's essentially what you do, you get equivalent results. Now, many people of us who can see through the equations will say, of course, in the normal case, you take the average of averages, that's still an average. It's also true if you estimate a probability, but also in certain nonlinear models, like when you estimate a logit, you still would get equivalent results. In some correlated data settings, and that's actually closer to what we like to do here, we do lose some information. One example is the simple but very generic compound symmetry model. So you get a bit of a different estimator. There is some precision loss, but if you do it well, that precision loss can be pretty much under control on the one hand, but the computational gain can be enormous on the other. So let me consider the situation of compound symmetry. in compound symmetry, I have, for example, repeated measures on a patient. And I'm going to keep it very simple. In realistic settings, we will make the model a bit more complicated, but I just want to give a perspective. So suppose that throughout time, there is no mean evolution. And again, that mean evolution with a constant mean mu can be generalized to a mean that is actually changing with time linearly, quadratically, etc. But for now, think of a flat profile. And then the compound symmetry setting says there's a constant variance that's in this case going to be sigma squared plus d. There's a constant covariance, there's a constant correlation, etc. Okay, so in that case, we see that the method works reasonably well. But now, closer to the situation that we are considering, we can also consider clusters of variable size. So, to give you a perspective behind the situation we are considering here, think of the very same simple model as before, but we collect our patients in different hospitals. And think of the letter K as indicating the hospital, or in a meta-analysis, K can indicate trial. Now, going back to the hospitals, if you select patients from different hospitals, it's very rare that all hospitals will deliver exactly the same number of patients. So, as a consequence, I have a variable cluster size. The cluster size in hospital 1 may be 10, in hospital 2 may be 5, in hospital 3 may be 7, etc. So, I'm now going to smaller trials. So, it may be that each of those sizes of number of patients per hospital is unique, and then all the C's will be equal to 1. Or it may be that there is replication, like there are two hospitals of size 3, etc., but the numbers could still be very small. Well, the thing is that in this setting, my parameters can, with likelihood, not be estimated in closed form. Now, for many of you who know this relatively simple model, but after all, it's a multivariate normal model with a simple mean structure and a simple variance-covariance structure. Well, you would think that these parameters are reasonably easy to estimate, and they are. But if we make the model a little bit more complicated, they may not be so easily estimated. And I'm not thinking necessarily only of really large studies, but also very small, simply because there's no closed form, we need to work iteratively. And if the trials are small, iteration can easily lead to divergence. You can run astray. You can lose your way in other ways. So, in that case, pseudo-likelihood can go to the rescue, because what you would then do, for example, is analyze each of the hospital data separately. And you can economize a little bit by saying, okay, all hospitals that produce the same number of patients we analyze together, but we leave it at that for now. Now, what you then have is, of course, a mean for the hospitals of size 3 and a mean for the hospitals of size 7, and the same for all other parameters. Of course, at the end of the day, we are going to average those. Then the question is, hey, how do we average? Do we average by simply taking the arithmetic average, or do we go for geometric averages of all the averages you know and can think about? Well, no. We need to think a little bit more cleverly about how we average indeed to get the parameter estimate. And that we do by stitching to the averaging and stitching together, of course, the same thing here, by choosing appropriate weights. Now, you can do that for the means and then for the variance component separately. Or if you really must, you can actually do that for all of the parameters at the same time with one or other linear combination. And now that we are at it, we of course can start thinking about which weights do we use, which weights are convenient, so that means easy to use, and which weights are optimal. Are there even optimal weights? Yes, we can show that there is something like optimal weight. As you can imagine, simply taking the average is awfully crude and will not be optimal. But another thought we can have is say, well, taking the average just like that's a little funny, But if we have, let's say, 12 hospitals of size 3 and only one hospital of size 7, well, shouldn't we give more weight, relatively speaking, to those 12 hospitals simply because there are more? And that's what we call proportional weights. And once you get the hang of that, you can, of course, go to many different weights. We can think of 34 different weights simply because we are 34 participants in this webinar and everybody can think of their own weight. Fine. But as it happens, some weights are really convenient and almost optimal at the same time. The problem with the optimal weights is to know them, you actually need to know the parameters already. But that's a little difficult. That's a little bit circular. So let's look at the simpler weights like constant and proportional and see what we can do with that. So let me give an example, and the example is taken from in a way a large study, but at the same time also a small study. Why? Because we are looking here at a European monitoring study in drugs and drug addiction conducted in Italy, and we are concerned in particular with tests taken in drug users seeking help in these centers, but especially their HCV, so the hepatitis C viral status is recorded. It's a large study because on average in each of the regions from Italy, and there are 20, we have like 4,000 patients more or less or respondents. That's large. But at the same time, there are only 20 regions. And now, whether you like it or not, that's what you're going to work with. If the mathematical statisticians come to you and say, this should be 60 regions or 100 regions, so we can do that. Italy is what it is. So in a context like this, we may be dealing with a small sample size in terms of the number of regions, regardless of how much replication there is in the region. And this is a very important lesson. If you have hierarchical data, like in a meta-analysis, in a multi-stage study, in a multi-stage survey, etc., the highest level unit, in this case the region, if that's small, you have a small sample size, almost regardless of how much replication you have in the center. So there you go with a study with like 800,000 people, you have only 20 regions. So what we look at here is the prevalence over the region, just to get a little bit of a background piece of information. Here is an evolution over time, and that's the type of data we deal with. It's like compound symmetry. It would be compound symmetry if all these lines would be horizontal, but they're not really very horizontal, and some are fairly far away from it. It may be on average more or less though. So okay, that's the setting we are dealing with. Just to introduce a little bit of notation to get the example underway. Zij is the number of cases out of Nij, so we have the epidemiological numerator and denominator. In region I, in year J, we have a time indicator and we have the success probability for that particular year, that particular region. So, okay, we can build a simple model where we have time effect, where we have region effect, time by region interaction, etc. And to allow for, to accommodate, in other words, within region correlation, we put in a random effect. So we're going to work with a random effect model in this context. Okay, we can analyze now, we can estimate these parameters, and as you see, T is an indicator for a year. Alpha J stands for, remember, the year, so alpha J is the year effect, and if you're interested in those, in one way or another, we can estimate these parameters using maximum likelihood, but we can also split the data in half. And splitting in half means we analyze the first portion separately, the first half of the study, and then the second half time-wise of the study, or we split it into four quarters of the study, etc. What we see is, if we examine this table a little bit, is that the estimates really don't change very much. And that even the standard there, because we would typically expect that there is a certain amount of loss of precision, the standard theirs don't change all that much. So that's encouraging. In case that full maximum likelihood would be prohibited, and of course I have chosen examples where it isn't prohibited, otherwise I cannot make a comparison, but in a setting where maximum likelihood would be prohibited, we at least have something, a method that comes to the rescue. Now, the first partitioning, as I said, is quarters, not time-wise, but actually region-wise. So we take 10 regions, then we analyze the second 10 regions, or we split it into four blocks of five regions. So dependent partitioning, that would split the sequence of repeated measures over time. And what we see here, if we compare, for example, maximum likelihood with the split where we go to altogether 15 different subsamples, we see that indeed the standard errors, and we should look at the second standard error, which is the so-called robust standard error. The standard error does change a little bit. We should look at the first standard error. We see that it does go up a little bit in some cases, in other cases quite a bit more. So here you do pay a price. Why is that? Well, the reason is, if you analyze a sequence over time at once, you allow for all information on the correlation to play a role. However, if you split your sequence in half, early measurements that are correlated with late measurements, that may be true, but you cannot get that into your estimated weights and so on. So, of course, there is going to be an efficiency. But if you apply mild splits, like into 2, into 5, into 10 feet, you see it's not all that bad. And what's more, if you really have a large amount of data, the split is going to make non-feasible computations feasible, one, but it will also imply a fairly modest split. Okay, with your permission, I will go to a second application. The second application is not a clinical trial, it's actually a developmental toxicity study here, just again to illustrate a certain number of ideas. In a nutshell, it's a study conducted in the United States in the Research Triangle Institute in North Carolina under the auspices of the U.S. National Toxicology Program, and we're dealing here with segment 2 studies. What are segments two studies conducted in rodents, in this case in mice? They are studies examining the effect of chemical compounds on the pregnancy, so on the developing fetus, during the period of major organogenesis. So the organogenesis, the very delicate period where the organs are formed, and actually a lot can unfortunately go wrong. In this sequence of studies, a number of compounds were considered, like, for example, ethylene glycol, and that's the example I will use. The major reason is ethylene glycol is relatively easy to say, at least compared to all the other compounds, unless you're a chemist. The other one I can say and remember is theophylline, but let's stay with ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol is used all over the place. They use it to de-ice your plane in winter, but they also use it in your fridge and freezer to extract the heat, so as to keep your food good for a certain amount of time, etc. So that's what it is. Now, what is the study? How does the study work done in these particular subjects, in these mice? What we have is clusters. Why clusters? Well, by definition, we don't necessarily want clusters, but we get clusters, quote unquote, for free, because these pregnancies produce between, let's say, 2 and 16, 17 fetuses. And these are the clusters. Not only are there clusters, the clusters are of variable size, because that's Mother Nature. The mice are randomized, or the damned, I should say. So the mothers are randomized over four groups, going from 0 to 3,000 milligrams per kilogram body weight per day. And each cluster is typically between, let's say, 25, 30, 50, 25 more or less different dams. So what are we interested in? We're interested in litter size. It's quite interesting to see how many fetuses there are per cluster. But more importantly, what are the malformation rates? The malformations are external malformation, so that's visible by naked eye, visceral malformation of evidence of organs, and then skeletal malformation that requires no explanation. And what you see, if those is going from small to large, that some of these malformation rates really skyrocket, really go very high. So here is an example of the, I have to explain this a little bit. Here is an example of what we now could do with various weighting methods. We have in the horizontal axis the cluster size, and as I said, it typically goes from something like 2, 3, 4, that's where it starts, but then really the cluster size shoots up, and at the far end we have a few clusters of liters, I should say, in this case of size 18, 19, 20, but really the bulk is kind of in the middle around 13, 14, etc. And what we then show is for the outcome, the outcome we analyze here is weight. So we could analyze the malformation rate, fine, and that's actually one of the primary objectives, but that would force me now to use to use binary outcomes. It's a little easier to apply the methodology for us now here in this webinar to a continuous outcome, and that's fetal weight. So when the fetuses are examined, so when they're sacrificed, we call it that way, and they're examined, you basically get to see their weight. The higher the dose, the lower the birth weight. And birth weight itself is not necessarily a problem, but it can be a risk factor for other events. So we see the distribution of the weights, and based on the distribution of the weights, now we can then construct we can construct weights for the weighted analysis that we're trying to do. So let me briefly recap what analysis we are doing. We group together all the clusters of a given size. So let's say the clusters of size 12, we all take together. For those, we can calculate the average weight by very simple, very important, non-iterative calculations. But based on those, we have it for size 12 now, for cluster size 12. We need to average that over all cluster size so we get the result for the entire data set. As I said, we can use proportional weights, we can use optimal weights, we can construct weights in many different ways, but what we see is that the weights that we consider here are actually fairly similar, no way, regardless of how we actually calculate the weight. So I'm using weights here, by the way, in two different meanings. There are the weights I use as a statistician in the statistical analysis, and there are the birth weights that I'm not the birth weights, but the weights at the end of the experiment when the rats or the mice are sacrificed. Those are the weights of interest. So these are the outcomes. Okay, so let's say in the units that we consider, maximum likelihood produces the benchmark, or restricted maximum likelihood for that matter. What we see is no matter what weights we are using, and it's actually the same for the other parameters, more or less, we get very similar results. So whereas maximum likelihood in some cases, especially if the experiment would become very small or very large, become prohibitive, these weighted methods that, again, I cannot emphasize it enough, allow us to do everything in a non-iterative way, produce very similar results. Standard errors are fairly decent, and there are a few technical caveats that I will skip over for today, but if you do that properly, you will actually also have valid precision estimation. So again, it's not the usual way of analyzing data, but if you're willing to take that on board, you have a non-iterative, very feasible method in small and very large samples that produces reasonable results. Okay, to give a perspective, and that's actually gently moving towards the final examples I wanted to give, to give a perspective on the time gain compared to the good efficiency, I will now introduce a an epidemiological study conducted here in Leuven, the Leuven diabetes study. So what is it? We have 120 general practices. And again, it's not terribly small, but it's not as many as we have patients. There are 2,500 patients, which is a reasonable sample size, but only 120 general practices, which is a source of clustering. The patients themselves are a source of clustering because they're followed up over time. So we basically have a three-level design. We may not use every aspect of the design now, but the fixed idea is we have a three-level design. We have 120 practices. We have patients nested within practices, two, and then three, we have repeated measures over time. What is the goal? The goal is to make sure that these patients have their targets under control. And the targets are based on low density cholesterol, hemoglobin, and blood pressure, solid blood pressure. Why targets? These three are continuous measures, but they're each of them ordinally categorized, so they're replaced by an ordinal version, and this ordinal version is in this study called target. You may like it or dislike it, but that's the way the study is done. The idea is to analyze these targets jointly. Now I have to revise a little bit my design, because my design is now of a certain four level. I have again practices one, patients two, then I have three, the targets, and these targets are recorded, are assessed longitudinally over time. So this is to give you an idea also for later reference. There's no reason to learn it by heart for now. There is a definition of the LDL target. So for example, I'll just give one example. If it's below 100 milligram per deciliter, then it's LDL target one, etc. There is, by the way, also missing data, and that's considerable. We should not neglect that. That's also something to keep in mind. Now, just to give you an idea of how things are done here, maximum likelihood is, okay, I bite the bullet and I analyze the data as they are. In full glory, I don't do any partitioning. A first type of partitioning is saying, well, three targets is too many, or three different outcomes, remember LDL, hemoglobin, and blood pressure, that's too many, I will analyze them pairwise and then stitch it together. Well, then the time goes from 7 minutes to roughly a minute and a half. Or what I can do is say I keep the three outcomes together, but the repeated measure sequence is too long and I'm going to partition that repeated measure sequence. Well, in the way we did it here, I'm omitting some details, you're also down to about a minute. And if you partition what we call horizontally and vertically, that is, you analyze pairwise rather than three-way, and you break up the longitudinal sequence into subsequences like early, middle, late, then you bring 7 minutes to 20 seconds. Now, 7 minutes is not bad. If you fit your model and you get it into 7 minutes, well, by the time this webinar is over, we could have actually done, let's say, seven of those analyses. But of course, if your data set gets a little bigger and you need to do quite a bit of model selection, you will be busy for a while. If you can do all of that in 20 seconds each, well, in 5 minutes, you can have done quite a bit of data analysis. And if we scale this up to higher data sets, to higher size data sets, I should say, the time gain is going to go from prohibitive to feasible. What about estimates? Well, I think at a glance, it's clear that even though there seems to be a gain that is considerable from method one, maximum likelihood, to four, the most partitioned method, the difference in standard errors and the loss of precision, if there is any, it's modest. In many cases, there isn't any. So it seems to work reasonably well. All right, so that's good for conclusion. Efficiency loss is very, very small. It's almost always, the relative efficiency is almost always 95% or higher just in case we apply the truth split in some cases through an extensive simulation study, which, with your permission, I don't report right now, you still have 85% say efficiency, which is pretty good. The model fitted, I didn't give too much detail here, but the model fitted is actually a generalized linear mix model. Now, again, without going into too much detail, a generalized linear mix model allows us to do numerical, it doesn't allow us, it actually forces us to do numerical integration. Now, numerical integration, you can do roughly, you can do a bit more precisely, or you can do painstakingly precise. Well, if we do it very precise, the result is better, obviously, but the computation time for this model with these data, which is not excessive, goes up to 10 hours. Now, that may be prohibitive. If you say, I'm a very patient person, no problem, okay, fine, but if you're a little bit less patient, it's good to know that if you do the double partitioning, you can do this analysis in 4 minutes. And even if you take only that away and say, hey, wait, that's interesting, but how does the method work again? It's good to look at some of the details again, or read some of the papers or some of the results in more detail. For medium-sized studies, a method like this brings it down from not so very feasible to definitely feasible. For big data, it goes from completely impossible to yes, we can do it, because not only do we break up the problem into subproblems, these subproblems can be made, in many cases, non-iterative, which again is very important. And what about small samples? In small samples, the full method can be prohibited because the hierarchical structure may be way too complex for the small number of patients that we have available. And there the method again makes it feasible rather than full likelihood, which would be not. Okay, and then as I said, we're gently moving towards the final examples. This is the last one I would like to consider. It's a study conducted by Janssen Pharmaceutica in Belgium, and the idea is the following. A number of compounds, potential compounds, need to be evaluated. Then again, without giving every detail of the experiment, there are 147 experts that rate the compounds as essentially, on the one hand, not recommended for further development, on the other hand, yes, recommended. Okay, now you may be asking yourself, hey, is everybody rating 22,000 compounds? Good number of compounds. Well, the answer is no. People have subsets. And ideally, these subsets would be properly randomized following one or other clever design. I would almost say, unfortunately, that's not entirely the case. Compounds were not allocated so nicely designed. And therefore, the number of compounds evaluated differs quite a bit from expert to expert. And there again, we are in a setting like, for example, in the NTP study, like in the hospital example, where the number of repetitions, and in this case, that would be compounds per expert, but in a way also the other way around, expert per compound, because various experts rate the same compound. Well, because all of that and the difference in sample size, let's call that imbalance, lack of balance, we may have a hard task in fitting a model to data like that in a likelihood fashion. What would be the goal of a model? Well, you would like to estimate a compound's, let's say, potential. And that potential could be expressed as the proportion of experts that actually consider that compound as viable. Now, a simple solution would be just average. But of course, that's not entirely fair. There are expert effects. And if a very critical expert is not evaluating this compound, but is evaluating another one, it may actually reverse the ordering. To avoid that, you would have all experts evaluating all compounds, but that's not fair. So in other words, you need to take out of the equation the expert effect. You're not really interested in that. It's a nuisance characteristic, but you need to take it out. The only thing you're really interested in is the compound viability. And then the next thing comes on the table. Some compounds are evaluated by a relatively small number of experts, others are evaluated by more. And that, of course, also makes a difference. So all of that calls for a sufficiently elaborate model indeed. Well, yes, having said that, we will start with a relatively simple model. If there are psychometricians around the table, people would start running at rash models and things like that. But let me take a model that is not a rash model, but kind of looks like it's a little bit in a dumbed down version. You have the logit of the probability of success of being recommended as an effect of compound data J, and then BI, the expert effect. There are, because there are so many compounds, there are 22,000 data J. So that's what we have to live with. Okay, so the way it's done now, and again, so late in the day, I'm not giving every detail on how the actual splitting is done, but basically, we are going to split the data set into clusters, analyze each of those clusters separately, and then again, stitch everything together. But because in this case, unlike, for example, in the longitudinal setting where you take the earlier measurement, the mid-time measurement, and the later measurement, here it's not terribly clear how you should, for example, split experts in early, late, etc. There is no such thing. Therefore, a resampling procedure is applied where the clusters are evaluated. The split is done several times, in other words, but that split is then done randomly once and repeated a number of times to stabilize the procedure. Now, if you randomize and repeat the method, you're again increasing the time you might take. But think of the previous example. If you go from 10 hours to 4 minutes, even if you were to resample 5 times, 4 minutes would become 20 minutes. If I'm not mistaken, 20 minutes would be much more feasible, way more viable than if you would have to wait for 10 hours. So yeah, you can add that twist to the procedure, and that would work well. Okay. So precisely, we create 30 subsets. So we partition the compounds in the clusters into 30 subsets. And the whole exercise is then repeated 20 times. OK. This whole procedure on a simple laptop computer took 96 hours. Now, that's a long time. In the previous example, likelihood was 10 hours. Here, the fast method, quote unquote, is 96 hours. What does that mean? Well, it means if you would do full likelihood, you could basically start your computer and then go on an extended vacation, and when you're back, it will not be there. It's simply not feasible with full likelihood in this case. If you would basically parallelize the problem carefully, you would bring the 96 hours down to, for example, 1 hour, because of course, you can analyze the subset all separately, but you can go further. And if you repeat the exercise 20 times, all it takes is 600 different processes, and you can bring it down to just a few minutes. That's definitely important. And especially if you're going to do things like this multiple times, it makes sense to invest in a good number of cores, a good number of computing cores that will pay off in the long run. So this is what typically would be provided as a result. You would have basically your compounds. Your compounds would be ranked. And for example, if you basically would simply do an unweighted bringing together of all the subsamples, you would get a certain number of compounds ranked from 1 to 8. You do see here that using proper weights does make a difference in compounds that come out not at all, will come out much more clearly if you go from unweighted to weighted. That may actually be a little bit unsettling, and I think it is in a case like this. But it's more an issue of the design rather than of the method. It actually shows that weights are important. If you don't weight and subsamples have more information than other subsamples, you're basically distorting the evidence. In a more balanced setting, this problem can be made. that's a side remark. Talking about remarks, it's good to make a few concluding remarks. Well, I took you maybe a little bit like a roller coaster, I'm aware, through a number of examples that nevertheless all share a common feature. They have either very small data set features or very large data set features, although not too extreme, except maybe the last example, and they have a certain amount of hierarchy. The hierarchy, which is a good thing, especially also in small samples, because it allows you to get more data out of a unit, out of a patient, out of a cluster, etc., but that makes the models cumbersome. And once again, in very small or very large samples, such a setting implies that full likelihood may be impossible. Same thing may apply to certain Bayesian methods. And then pairwise likelihood, pseudo-likelihood, split sampling techniques can be used, perhaps in various ways in the same example, like we did in the diabetes study, so as to speed up computation, make computations feasible, not only by breaking up, but also by allowing simpler estimation methods in each part of the breakup. So in each sub-data set, we may, in other words, have non-iterative methods, whereas in the full data set, that would not be possible. So in all sorts of ways, we try to squeeze out as much computational gain as possible without paying too much a price in terms of efficiency, as we have seen throughout the example. Okay. And we did see, I think, that it can lead to good CPU time gain, to, at the very end, considerable to almost infinite CPU gain. And by that I mean, well, if full likelihood is not possible at all, but the split sample method breaks it down to 96 hours, but if you're a bit more efficient, 1 hour, well, I would think that's then infinitely better. Better than something, especially if it has good efficiency, is known to be consistent and asymptotic normal. Than nothing at all. Okay, how this is applied in your particular setting or in a particular trial or epidemiological study or whatever environment you are considering, that of course remains to be seen. All I hope to do is give you a top line overview, see how the methodology works and what the game can be. And if that has kind of triggered some curiosity or interest, I think I'm happy. And the only thing I'm going to add is I'm very grateful for your attention, and with that, I would like to thank you for the part from my side here and now. So once again,